Hi, this is Dr. A, and we're going to do an overview of the anatomy and physiology of the skeletal system. So the functions of the skeletal system is, first, it's the internal framework of the body. Everything is attached to it. It supports the body. It protects the internal organs. It is a point of attachment for your muscles, and as your muscles contract, they pull on bones and it allows movement. It produces blood cells because it contains marrow, and the bone marrow is where blood cells are produced, and it stores minerals like calcium and phosphate, but also magnesium. Each bone is a body organ. It has a blood supply, nerve supply, and lymphatic vessels, and bones are connected to each other via ligaments to form the skeleton. And then the skeleton protects the organs and stores minerals, as we already stated, as a function, and the bone marrow in the bones produces the blood cells, and then the joints give the skeleton its flexibility and allows for movements. Bones are also called osseous tissue. They are one of the hardest materials in the body. They are formed by the gradual process of ossification. So when a baby is being formed in the womb, the little fetal skeleton is first made of cartilage, and then that cartilage is slowly replaced by osteoblast, which osteoblasts, if you think, build bone, right? And those osteoblasts, as they build bone, they mature into osteocytes. And the way it works kind of is the blast activation starts building bone, and once it builds bone all around itself and finds itself completely encased in bone, then it turns into an osteocyte. And so they do that and slowly turn the cartilage into bone. So let's talk about bone structure. So the long bones are longer than wide. Examples of long bones are your femur, which is your leg bone, and your humerus, which is your arm bone. The short bones are roughly as long as they are wide. Examples are your carpals, which are your wrist bones. And if you look at the wrist bones, they look like little blocks. And your tarsals, which are your ankle bones. Your flat bones are plate-shaped. They're kind of flat-ish. The example is the sternum, which is the breastbone, the scapula, which is your shoulder blade, and the pelvis, which is your hip bones. And then your irregular bones are shaped very irregular. You can't hardly even describe that shape, and an example would be the vertebrae. So let's continue with the bone structure. The majority of the bones in your body are long bones, and long bones have two parts. They have the diaphysis and the epiphysis. So the diaphysis is the central shaft, or like the long part of the bone, and it contains a medullary cavity. So that's the cavity in which the bone marrow is. The epiphysis, so epi, think top, and so it's actually top and bottom, but it's the wider portion at either end of the bone. And you have articular cartilage that covers the epiphysis to allow for smooth movement. And because of where all your long bones are, you have a lot of movement going on, right? And then the periosteum covers the rest of the bone. And what's interesting is, so the periosteum is almost like a sac that covers the bone, but it's like stuck to the bone, right? And the periosteum becomes ligaments and tendons as it attaches bone to bone and muscle to bone, and then the part that's left, that where the articulation is where the articular cartilage is, or where the articulation, like, joint, right? The hard exterior of the bones is called compact or cortical bone, and it's found in both the epiphysis and the diaphysis on the outside of it, and that's what makes your bones strong. And then cancellous or spongy bone is found inside of the bone, and it has more of a lattice work look. It has spaces that contain the red bone marrow. It is found in some parts of all bones, and the point of the spongy bone is to make your bones lighter. So if our bones were nothing but compact bone, our skeletons would be really heavy. So this is a diagram of what a long bone looks like. Okay, so the long part of the shaft is the diaphysis with a medullary cavity and the marrow, which can be yellow if it's a fat marrow, or if it's a red marrow, then it's a blood-producing marrow. And then we have the diaphysis, and then so you have the distal end and the proximal end. If you refer back to our body organization in lecture on directional terms, so proximal is going to be closer to the center of the body, and distal is going to be further away. And so bones have a direction, point of attachment, etc. So, you know, in this bone, this is, you know, the proximal end and the distal end of this long bone here. And so on this epiphysis here, the end of it, you can see the amount of spongy bone that is present to make it lighter. This epiphyseal line is the growth plate. So we have those in all the long bones, especially, well, all the long bones, but it's present in these long bones. So this is where new bone is added as a child grows, and then it closes when you become an adult. You have the articular cartilage that wraps around the outer part here, where it joins up to another bone into a joint. And then you can see a cross section here where you have the compact bone and then the spongy bone. And you can see the framework of the spongy bone. So, oh, and then this also here illustrates the periosteum, which is the covering of the bone. In the periosteum, it has a function. It is quite important. So part of it, like, for example, if you have a fracture or something is, you know, damaged on your bone, the periosteum is what generates the beginning of healing. So the creation of new bone, you know, elimination of the bones that what's been destroyed, but then laying new bone and fixing the break. So let's talk about the projections and depressions that are found on bones. They have specific terms. So the head is the large, smooth, ball-shaped end of a long bone. And the condyle is a smooth, rounded portion at the end of a bone. An epicondyle is a projection above or on a condyle. A trochanter is a large, rough process, and a tubercle is a small, rough process. A tuberosity is a large, rough process. A sinus is a hollow cavity within a bone. A foramen is a smooth opening for nerves and blood vessels. A fossa is a shallow cavity or depression within a bone, and a fissure is a split-like opening. So let's talk about the skeleton. The skeleton has two divisions. We have the axial skeleton, so think axis, think middle, right? So it contains the bones of the head, neck, spine, chest, and trunk. And then the appendicular skeleton contains everything that allows, you know, for a lot of movement. So your arms and your legs and what attaches them to the actual skeleton. So that would be the pectoral girdle and upper extremities. So that's your arms and your shoulders, you know, that attach your arms to your chest. And then the pelvic girdle and lower extremities. So the pelvic girdle is your hip bones, and then your legs are your lower extremities, and they attach to the lower part of your vertebrae. So we're going to start with a skull here, top of the axial skeleton. And we're going to go over all the bones that make up the skull. And so as if you think back of, you know, starting with a baby, you know, with these being cartilage, the ossification starts kind of in the center and then grows until you have these plates meet, and then when they meet, you have these sutures right here. Okay, so frontal bone is right here, parietal bone right here, occipital bone back of the head, temporal bone where your ears are. This is where your ear is going to be. Sphenoid bone is right here, this little depression that you can rub if you have a headache, right? Zygomatic bone is going to be your cheek right here. Maxilla is right here, is your top where bone that your top teeth are attached to. Mandible is the one that moves and allows for chewing, where your bottom teeth are attached. And then your nasal bone for your nose. the ethmoid bone right here is like in the back of your eyeball. And lacrimal bone is like here inside here where your lacrimal is tear, where tear ducts and stuff are. Next, we're going to look at the vertebral column or spinal column, if you will. They are, you know, five divisions, if you will, of the vertebral column. So we have first, we have cervical, which is at the top. Cervical means neck. Then we have thoracic, which is where the thorax and rib cage and stuff is attached to. Then we have lumbar, which is lower back. And then we have the sacrum and coccyx, which are included in the pectoral girdle. So those are the five parts. So let's go back here. You have seven cervical vertebrae, and C1 and C2 are the atlas and axis, so the first two vertebrae that attach the skull to the vertebral column and allow a lot of your head movements like this and all of that. And then, so it goes C1 to C7, and then you have the 12 thoracic ones, which are attached to the 12 pairs of ribs. So, you know, that's T1 through T12 for the, you know, where the 12 ribs are, the pairs of ribs. Okay, and then you have the five lumbar, then the sacrum and the coccyx. If you struggle remembering the numbers, the one trick that I've kind of kept in my head is 7 plus 5 equals 12. So you have your 7 at the top, then 12, then 5. I don't know if that helps, but that's how I remember it. Next, let's look at the rib cage. So you have 12 pairs of ribs, just like we already stated, are attached to the 12 thoracic vertebrae. And of in those 12, you have 7 that are true, and then really 5 that are other, they're false or floating ribs. The 7 true ribs are true ribs because the rib attaches directly to the sternum, which is the breastbone, which is the middle part here of the rib cage. And so if you go here, you can see 1 is attached, 2 is attached, 3 is attached, 4, we get 5, and then we get 6 and 7. So they all attach directly here to the sternum. Okay. And then the next 3 are false ribs. So they're false ribs because their cartilage is actually attaching to the last true rib and not actually to the sternum. And then the last 2 are floating ribs, and they're not attached to anything. Okay, so this cartilage is referred to as costal cartilage, costal meaning rib. The little protrusion here from the sternum is the xiphoid process, and that's what you locate to find where to position your hands when you do chest compressions. The main part of the sternum is the body, and then the top of the sternum is called the manubrium. So let's look at the appendicular skeleton now. So the pectoral girdle attaches the upper extremities to the axial skeleton. So it articulates with the sternum, the breastbone, and the vertebral column, right? Your back, spinal cord, etc. It consists of the clavicle up here, the bones up here, and the scapula, which are the shoulder blades. And the upper extremity is the arm, and the arm is made of the humerus, the ulna and the radius, which are your forearm, and then the carpals, which are your wrist, metacarpals, which are the bones of the hand, and phalanges, which are your fingers. Next is the pelvic girdle. It's also called the os coxae, the innominate bone or the hip bone. It attaches the lower extremity to the axial skeleton. It articulates with the sacrum posteriorly, so in the back, and it consists of the ilium, the ischium, and the pubis. Those are the bones of the hip bones, if you will, or the bones of the pelvic girdle. The lower extremity is the leg. The leg is made of the femur or thigh bone, the patella, which is a kneecap. The tibia and the fibula, the tibia is a shin bone and the fibula is the lower leg bone. So tibia and fibula are next to each other. The tarsals, which are your ankle bones, metatarsals are foot bones, and the phalanges, which are your toes. And then lastly, we have the joints. So joints are formed where two bones meet. They are also called an articulation because it allows for movement. The three types of joints are based on the movement that is allowed. So we have synovial joints, freely moving joints. So think fingers, arms, legs, everything that allows you to move a lot are synovial joints and have synovial fluid. Their cartilaginous joints allow for slight movements. Did movement in your spinal cord and stuff. So we have, some movement, rotation, stuff like that. And then fibrous joints allow for almost no movement. So your sutures of your skull are fibrous joints, for example. Bones are held together by ligaments or strong bands of connective tissue. And some synovial joints will contain a bursa, which is a sac-like structure. All right, so this is an example of a synovial joint. So remember, synovial joints allow for a lot of movement. So we have two bones here. We can see the compact bone and the spongy bone in the medullary cavity. But then in the joint itself, we have a synovial membrane. And the synovial membrane encapsulates here this synovial fluid in the, inside the joint cavity. And then the lining of the bone here is where the articular cartilage is, right there. And the outer capsule here is the joint capsule right there. And then we see some ligaments also that are represented. And so this is very important. So we need the joint fluid, the synovial fluid, which is, if you've ever seen joint fluid, synovial fluid, it's very viscous, very slippery. Okay, which allows for good movement, and then the cartilage protects the ends of the bones. If somebody has problems, like let's say knee problems where they've had arthritis for a long time, a lot of times what happens is there's a wearing away of the cartilage, and there's hardly any more joint fluid, synovial fluid here, and then ends up being bone rubbing against bone, and that creates a lot of pain and inflammation. So. All right, well, that's the last slide, so I appreciate your attention. I'm going to continue the lessons with the terms for the skeletal system. So you can join me in the next video if you want to. And so this is your overview of the skeletal system. Thank you.